Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to welcome you to the keynote presentation of Race, Roots, and Resistance, Revisiting the Legacies of the Black Power Movement. I think it's been a wonderful 2-3 days, and we look forward to tomorrow being equally as good. I'd like to use this opportunity to thank the committee inside African American Studies that put on this activity. Jennifer Hamer, Will Patterson, Eric McDuffie, Mark Perry, John Jennings, Chris Benson, Carla Bloom. Is Carla here? Okay, at any rate, people have been constantly talking, giving me credit for this activity. Our keynote speaker, Kathleen Cleaver, received a JD from Yale University in 1989. She is the senior lecturer in African American Studies and a senior research scholar at the Yale Law School. She also is a former member of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, and she was communications secretary at the Black Panther Party. I think most of us know her in relationship to the Black Panther Party, one of the most heroic organizations and social networks in that very critical and tumultuous period that we know of as the 1960s. This organization made tremendous advances across the board. They received a lot of criticism around gender politics, but I would urge anyone to take a look at the Panthers and their approach to gender, and then look back at other social movements in this country's history, particularly those in that same period, and then make the same criticism. I think it's very difficult to do. She also serves as co-director of the Human Rights Research Fund, which is a part of a network of anti-racist organizations engaged in documenting human rights violations of US citizens who challenge the racist military policies that injure their communities. I suspect that that organization has a lot of work today. Okay. You know, I'm gonna make just a few more comments off of this printed version and point to the publications of Dr. Cleaver. She has co-edited Liberation, Imagination, and the Black Panther Party 2001. Her essays have appeared in Critical Race Feminism, Critical White Studies, The Promise of Multiculturalism, and the Black Panther Party Reconsidered. In addition to these numerous publications and magazines and journals, she is also the recipient of the Alphonse Fletcher Fellowship for African and African American Studies from the Department of African American Studies at Harvard University. And she, in conjunction with a fellowship from the Center for Scholars and Writers at the New York Public Library, she used those two fellowships to complete her most recent book. Is it here? Target Zero, A Life in Writing by Eldridge Cleaver. Let me just now say, let me bring you Kathleen Cleaver.
It's a great crowd. It's a wonderful sight just to see all your energetic, expectant, lively faces. Anyone who teaches in a classroom, you know how thrilling that is. So I know you don't have to take notes. There's no test. So I'm just delighted to be here. It's an honor to be invited to give the keynote at this very significant conference that really has the energy of a happening or a movement or demonstration in the sense that people are excited and they think it means something to them. And so I want to extend a tremendous thanks to particularly Dr. Patterson and the chair of the African American Studies and Research Program, and to Professor Hamer. Those are the people I've actually met and seen, and I know there are many, many others who volunteered and helped pull this together. So I think we should all give them another round of applause for this tremendous event. Well, I'm going to get right into this topic. I was asked to send an abstract some time ago, which was really problematic because it's hard enough for me to come up with a title. And so they said, I think that's a little, if I give you an abstract, that might not be what I talk about. So they said, whatever you'll give us. So I sent the title, Self-Determination, the Black Power Movement, Self-Determination, Transformation, and Sabotage. Because that's my category of experience with the Black Power Movement, an experience that begins with the beginning of that movement. So what I want to go through is my interpretation and understanding of how it was a movement for self-determination, only a very small fraction of how transformative it was, particularly in the way it inspired and generated the activity that's called the Black Panther Party, which is very, very multifarious. I mean, it was a lot more than a party, and really many, many parties and many activities under one name. And then, in the time that's left, talk a little bit more, outline how that movement was sabotaged, because you are the recipients much more of its legacy of sabotage than anything else. So I think you have more to say about that than I do. But just to get started, I wanted to share with you a statement that I found very touching, something that Stokely Carmichael said, and I can't ever forget it once I heard it. And he said that, speaking of his experience as an organizer, SNCC organizer in Mississippi, he said, "In Mississippi, I learned what I never learned from the most brilliant professors I sat under. He said, I learned how not to be ashamed of my blackness." And you can see this clip in a film called Fundi, The Life of Ella Baker. I believe it's in other films. But that tells you something about where the Black Power Movement came from, in the sense that before anyone could ever call for power and attach black to that call, there's another process that had to take place, and that is to recover or destroy the shame that was encased in blackness. We all know that the most widely publicized call for black power happened in Greenwood, Mississippi, and it happened late in the evening in June after Carmichael later changed his name to Touré, but since he was Carmichael when all these happenings were taking place, I'm going to refer to him as Carmichael. and this was probably number 27 or 28 arrest. He'd been arrested in Cambridge during the demonstrations with Gloria Richardson. He'd been arrested in many places. He'd been arrested in the freedom rides in Mississippi. He'd been to jail in Mississippi many times. And this particular arrest during the March Against Fear across Mississippi was in Greenwood, and there's something special about Greenwood. That was a site of SNCC organizing. Greenwood was not a town organized by the NAACP or SCLC or CORE. It was a town in which SNCC organizers had gone into because it's a very dangerous and very poor Mississippi Delta town. So he was in, you might say, his home turf. And during the rally, after the march had stopped for the evening, they were launching this call and response. What do we want? People would say, freedom now. That was what they used to say. And Willie Ricks, who'd worked with Carmichael and SNCC for many years, Willie Ricks, let's point this out. He's now known as Mukasa. But most of the SNCC organizers came from college. They were college students who came down and worked in this movement. Willie Ricks said that James Forman found him in a pool hall. You know, he didn't go to college. Willie Ricks also very rarely got arrested. Because when there was a situation in the South as a demonstrator, what Ricks would do was put on his, like, straw hat and shuffle away. Just blend in. He could do something that most people didn't know how to do. So Willie Ricks is shuffling through the crowd and telling people as they're responding, what do we want? No, say black power, say black power, say black power. And that's what they did say. And so the television cameras projected all over the country, at night this picture of Stokely Carmichael, who had just come out of jail, who was really angry at this last arrest, saying, what do we want? Black power, a crowd screaming at the top of their lungs in the blackness of Mississippi in response to Stokely Carmichael, we want black power. I don't know if any of you can imagine how extraordinary that was. It was extraordinary to this day because everybody wants to, not everybody, but scholars particularly, they're very anxious to tell you when the Black Power movement ended and how it was sabotaged and what happened to it. I'm very tired of that. I mean, really, you know, there's a book out, I'm sure you're all familiar with, that tells us the Black Power movement, 1965 and 1975, okay? We gotta cut this off. So, because black power is a part of a process that in Mississippi was a process of learning the techniques of how to resist and overcome a level of subjugation that was closer to slavery than anywhere else in the United States. So I think it's significant that this comes out of Mississippi, one of the most terroristic parts of Mississippi. And it comes from someone who went there as part of a movement of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee and learned there how not to be ashamed of being black. So black power arose from the context of a social movement. It was a social movement that inspired me, that I followed, that most of the young people of my generation were observing, inspired by, more observed, less were inspired by, and even less actually wanted to join. But it was a social movement for very concrete things. It wasn't an abstract way of interpreting history. It was a social movement to bring about changes like an end to inferior education, end to exclusion from the political process, end to legal segregation, end to economic domination, and an end to racist terrorism, which was not at all controlled by this government, the same government that could send troops all the way around the other side of the world to bring democracy to Vietnam, but they couldn't stop the Klan from killing people in Mississippi. So I was fortunate, I think, that when I came into the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, when I joined SNCC, it was a few weeks after that march. It was in New York, where I was a student, and I was looking for a job for the summer, and I had met one of the new Black Power members of the group in SNCC that supported Black Power. You have to understand, in an organization that was as fluid and individualistic in certain sense, it was an organization that functioned on a principle of consensus decision making. And there was a lot of discussion about what the policies were and what the direction were. Everyone didn't agree with someone they like to refer affectionately to as Star Michael. Everyone didn't agree with Star Michael's Black Power at that time. But they had sent a new director to the New York office who did, Ivanhoe Donaldson, another organizer out of Mississippi. And I met him in the summer, and he asked me what I was doing that summer. And I said, well, I was looking for a job. And he said, well, I'm looking for a secretary. Why don't you come down to the SNCC office? We'll see, you know. Now, I've been wanting to get into SNCC for 5 years, so this was extraordinary. I was thrilled. It's like my goal had been, you know, my prayers had been answered, although I had stopped praying by then. But I came into SNCC from being a sophomore at Barnard, and this was the most important thing that I could do with my life. And as also, I saw SNCC in a particular context, the context, as everyone does, you see things that are part of your experience. So I interpreted Black Power in the context of having seen national independence movements in Africa and Asia firsthand. I had lived with my parents in India, which had overcome British colonialism. I lived with my parents in Sierra Leone at the time it became independent from Britain. I had seen countries around the world becoming independent from European colonialism, French or British colonialism. And so, therefore, this sense of black power, what to me was like, here we are, we're going to become independent of segregation and white supremacy, which was inchoately a similar form of domination. I couldn't have explained it to you then. I can explain it to you now because I've been to college and I have a law degree and I can read about colonialism. However, at the time, I just felt it intuitively. And because the historical subjugation to which we had been subjected as black people was so deep, so insidious, we were people who were descendants of slaves who were not part of the Constitution, not part of the so-called people of the United States until the 13th and 14th and 15th Amendment amended the Constitution. We were not included in that independence that Americans supposedly gained from Britain. There's a 1848 case in Virginia. I teach the law of slavery and anti-slavery, so don't be surprised if you aren't familiar with these cases. Very few people are. But there's a case in which slaves who had supposedly, they were supposed to have been freed by their owner's will, brought a suit for damages because they hadn't received their freedom. And the court ruled that they weren't entitled to damages, saying that slavery is with us, that means them, an institution founded upon a distinction of races, one of which is subject to the control and domination of the other. The servile race, from color and other physical traits, carry with them indefinitely the marks of inferiority and degradation. And so that's what I was experiencing, even though I couldn't have quoted that to you, and that's how I responded, knowing that these characteristics of slaves had been merged into disabilities that were political, and that somehow whether the physical appearance and the political inabilities become one and the same, and you can't separate them. So that was the context in which a call for black power coming out of Mississippi to the larger society is almost incomprehensible. What do you mean? What does it mean? Immediately, the press, because on that march against fear, Martin Luther King, Floyd McKissick, the director of CORE, Roy Wilkins, and many, many others were present. And so the media, as they do, immediately, reporters would go and ask them, what do you have to say? I mean, we hear what Carmichael had to say. So they were, well, what do you have to say? And of course, Roy Wilkins, executive director of the NAACP, was quite obliging. And he said, oh, that's racism in reverse. To me, that's incoherent. Martin Luther King was more generous. He said, I think it's an unfortunate choice of words. And Floyd McKissick was supportive. But so there's immediately an effort where you see unity on an action and a march to divide that. Now, the Black Panther Party, which was created in October of 1966, so it's just a few months, it's the fall after this historic march, has created a 10-point platform and program, a statement of principles, a statement of what it wanted, what it believed. But this was the first step. This was the beginning of the Black Panther Party, the creation, the drafting of this document. Point one was, we want power to determine the destiny of our own black community. So therefore, black power is heard by those people who are in the struggle as a claim or demand, an insistence on self-determination. I think it was clear in 1966 that it came out of a radical context, a movement for a radical change in the social and economic relationship between blacks and the larger power structure, a dynamic, a fluid movement that was inspiring an entire generation. And it was not a movement to go to a different country, to pick up and go somewhere else, or to segregate yourselves into an independent state, or to assimilate into the mainstream, It was a movement to have self-determination and to guarantee citizens, black citizens, the right to determine their own destiny. As Malcolm X said in 1964, we are not fighting for integration. We are not fighting for separation. We are fighting for the right to live as free human beings in this society. That's not what you normally hear about Malcolm X. That's not what they were reporting about Malcolm X in 1964, but that's what we were hearing. That's what we were doing. We were in a contest. We were at a time when the impact of the Vietnam War was becoming harsher and harsher within black communities. After the Voting Rights Act was passed in 1965, within weeks, there's a huge uprising in Watts. It went on for days. Millions of dollars in property destroyed. What triggered that? Police violence. The rumor that the Los Angeles police had killed a man who ran through a red light, is taking his wife to the hospital. Actually, he wasn't killed, but the rumor was so powerful, people believed it and tore up. And the understanding, the extraordinary recognition that there was that much rage, that much violence, that much explosive energy in a poor, subjugated ghetto area had a tremendous power, both negative and positive. It had something to do with the formation of the Black Panther Party, in that a group called Community Action Patrol came out of that rebellion. They patrolled the police to make sure that these events wouldn't continue to happen. The Black Panther Party actually initiated patrols of the police in Oakland, although their patrols were armed, and the Community Action Patrol, I think they just carried radios or tape recorders. So it was not an accident. It was not a blank slate. It was a concrete move in a particular direction. Carmichael, in fact, did have a BA in philosophy. He was highly educated. But I think the notion of black power was not abstract, but it was sort of like a caption for the organizing goals of that phase of the struggle, which radicals were beginning to call the black liberation struggle, not the freedom struggle, but the black liberation struggle. And I want to quote something about Stokely that was written at, it was published in Ramparts Magazine and part of an article called My Father and Stokely Carmichael. It was written in 1967 by Eldridge Cleaver, who was assigned, I think his first assignment after being released from prison was to cover Stokely Carmichael. And part of that article, he wrote, "There's always been a drama in the black psyche in America that a generation of men would arise and go back to the South to strike the chains from the slave master's minds. Stokely Carmichael belongs to that first generation of Negroes who had the courage to return. The generation of Negroes who kicked off the sit-ins among black college students is different from anything that has gone before. Now it is 6 years later, and these youngsters have grown into battle-tested veterans. They have become conscious revolutionaries. Having started out trying to change the world by forcing America to re-examine its conscience, these revolutionaries have been frustrated in that approach, and they now look with scorn upon doctrines that ask them to love their enemy." Carmichael says, "When we first went down south, the papers tried to make it look like we wanted to sit next to Bull Connor and Ross Barnett and eat hot dogs. That's a lie. We went down south to render those crackers impotent over our lives." They went south, and in this fact is contained a revolution. There's a vast difference between Negroes who are willing to go south and all those generations whose ambition it was to flee the South. Now, how many of you here in this room have grandparents or parents whose ambition it was to flee the South? Just let me know. I would think there's more. "A cycle has been completed," he wrote. "The real work for the liberation of black people has begun. A new cycle has begun in another way, too. The great popular black nationalist leaders like Marcus Garvey, Elijah Muhammad, and Malcolm X all never finished high school. Stokely Carmichael is the first of his stature to receive a college degree. The history of the national liberation struggles in Africa and in the world in general hints the success of the struggle for liberation awaits the arrival of intellectuals who have thrown off the shackles of the slave and are willing to put their talents and genius selflessly to work for the masses. Up until now, one of the traditional complaints of the black masses had been of the treachery of black intellectuals. But today, the college educated, and today means 1967, the college educated Leroy Jones, who was later became Amiri Baraka, is part of a new generation of black writers, just as Stokely Carmichael is part of a new generation of black leaders. James Forman, who became executive director of SNCC, was a high school history teacher in Chicago. I think he was a graduate of Roosevelt University. And he would count as a black intellectual. And he was considering moving to Atlanta to take over the job of running temporary student nonviolent coordinating committee. And by late fall of 60 had become the student nonviolent coordinating committee. So he says, although he'd agreed to serve as executive secretary, he had serious doubts as whether this group, because he thought they were really disorganized, this group could build a mass organization of which I dreamed. And he said, joining SNCC meant not just deciding to take a year off of school, but making a lifetime commitment. He was easily 10 years older than most of the students in the room. He said, I respected their youth and realized that at their age, I was not involved in the type of service to people that they were. But what made him make the decision? The turning point was, he said, I was convinced that there existed in SNCC the energy, the talent, the brain power, the determination, and the courage to change certain values in this country. One of the most important values to be changed was that a person should work for money. These students were saying that they were more concerned with human rights than with money. They were not driven by the profit motive which dominates the society. And they were willing to demonstrate this with their lives. And he felt, he says, if this idea could grow among young black people, we would usher in revolutionary change. Now, in the preface to the book, Black Power, The Politics of Liberation in America by Stokely Carmichael and Charles Hamilton, is a very clear statement. They write, the stakes are really very simple. If we fail, that is, to take care of the business of getting ourselves together as a people, if we fail, we face continued subjection to a white society that has no intention of giving up willingly or easily its position of priority and authority. If we succeed, we will exercise control over our lives politically, economically, and psychically. We will also contribute to the development of a viable, larger society. In terms of ultimate social benefit, there is nothing unilateral about the movement to free black people. This book calls for a reorientation of the values which dominated the middle-class white world. Values which he admits the civil rights movement had not deeply questioned. If anything, Carmichael pointed out, it has accepted those values and institutions without fully realizing their racist nature. Reorientation means an emphasis on the dignity of man, not the sanctity of property. It means the creation of a society where human misery and property are repugnant to that society, not an indication of laziness and lack of initiative. The creation of new values means the establishment of a society based, and here he borrowed from John O'Killen's Black Man's Burden, a society based on free people, not free enterprise. To do this, he concludes, means to, quote, modernize, indeed to civilize this country. They identified black power as a call to black unity, a call to recognize and value our distinct cultural heritage, to build our sense of community, to define our own goals, to lead our own organizations, to reject racist institutions and values of the larger society. So the fundamental premise of their agenda, they insisted, was establishing group solidarity, which was essential to gain a position of strength from which to negotiate with the larger pluralistic society. So they say the goal of self-determination and self-identity inherent in Black power is the full decision-making participation that in the process that affects Black lives. Now, how many of you have experienced full decision-making in the process that affects Black lives? How many times has anyone asked you, have you had that experience? Well, are you? Are you asked if you have participation in the decisions that affect your lives? Well, that was one of the things that was so clear about the 60s, that people stood up and said, we want to participate. The government decides to take people to Vietnam to fight. We said, no. Carmichael was, hell no, we won't go. We want to participate in that decision. We want to participate in how money is spent. I have to point out to you, in a democracy, the government belongs to the people. But in this society, they act like the people belong to the government. So clearly, the call for Black power was to be a collective process, to initiate a collective process to change the community dynamic and the community's relationship to the structures of authority, not merely a means for individual aggrandizement, individual advance, which seems to be the motor of the consumer-oriented, capitalist, globalizing society in which we're living. What I heard when I heard Black power was demand for solidarity among ourselves, unity, self-determination for Black people. I heard it in the context of African liberation movements, Asian independence movements, but I also heard it in something else, because at that point I was living in Morningside Heights. I was a student at Barnard. Morningside Heights, for those of you who don't know, is right, it's basically Harlem, but it's the part of Harlem that Columbia is in, so they have a different name, and more white people live there. After Bill Clinton moved his office to 125th Street, the officials of Columbia would say, yeah, we're in Harlem, we're in Harlem. But back then in 66, it was Morningside Heights. And so when Carmichael published this piece, What We Want, What We Believe, about Black power, because he was bombarded. You wouldn't have experienced this, but at that time in the 60s, it was always this, well, what do you want? What do you want? What do you people want? And after they heard Black power, you know what they stopped asking? They have not asked since. What do you want? So he told them in this article that integration, that's also another term you rarely hear. I have to explain it to you, because all you have heard, most of you younger people, all of you who don't have white hair, or all of you who have hair that's real, what you've heard about is called diversity, okay? I don't know where they got that word from. I think they got it from a corporate board meeting, but the word, the policy that was articulated by the government was called integration. Now, what we were doing was trying to end segregation, gain the recognition of human and civil rights, insist that the law that protected our rights be enforced and the laws that denied our rights be changed. But the policy of the government said, you want integration. So what Carmichael in this article, What We Want, said, integration is just a subterfuge for white supremacy. And when I heard that, it was like a light went on, because here I was in Morningside Heights going to Barnard, so I guess that's integrated, but why did I feel so left out? Why did I feel like I didn't count? I wasn't there. No one was asking me anything. I think it was after Black power that I cut my hair and let it grow in an afro. because I hadn't seen anyone. I'd seen people with afros, they called them natural at the time, coming out of Mississippi, but everybody I'd seen was brown or dark. And I said, well, what would I look like with an afro? Then I saw a girl, a roommate, sister of one of the three black women at Barnard. And she had an afro, and she could cut hair. I said, I want one too. So this is a sense of being who you are, expressing your identity, having that recognized, having that acknowledged. He also said, integration is disintegration. He wrote this in 1966. He said, integration is despicable because it teaches you in order to have a good education, you have to go to a white school. In order to live in a good house, you have to go to a white neighborhood. So the premise is that anything is all black is bad. And he used to love to say, but I'm all black and I'm good. So we have to understand that the development of these policies, and I say policies as opposed to practice, of integration, this claim for integration, was an outgrowth of the Cold War agenda of the 1950s and the early 60s in the contest for supremacy against what was called the Soviet bloc or the communist world. We weren't that far from the McCarthy era at that time, although people in SNCC paid no attention to that. They could care less about red baiting. But the issues of how the United States, with its racial segregation, its racial dehumanization, how these policies played in the United Nations, where more and more independent African states were joining and were voting, and there was a contest between who is going to, what side are you going to be on, with the Soviets or with the U.S.? And so there was a need, a very important need, and the State Department expressed this very clearly to the Supreme Court when they were considering the Brown decision on segregation in public education, that we needed a clear statement, because we're having trouble internationally convincing Africans and Asians that we are democratic and we would be on their side. And so you could see that the policy statement for an integration is going to an audience that's not those children sitting in segregated schools. How many of you here, when you went to elementary school or high school, went to a high school in which you were like the majority of the people in that school? I can't see out there, but are most of the hands out there black? Okay, white students, how many of you went to a school, a high school, where you were like the majority? Okay, that doesn't tell me a whole lot about integration, which is why we don't use that word anymore. But the concept, Martin Luther King made it clear that what we were dealing with, what they called integration, he called tokenism. You may have heard that. During the early years of the protests against segregation and dehumanization, the official opposition on the part of the states was something he called massive opposition to change. You know, George Wallace standing in the doorway saying, segregation today, segregation tomorrow, segregation forever. That's opposition, massive. But then when you have something like allowing one or two black students into a university, like when Charlene Hunter Gault and Hamilton Holmes, two Negroes, were the first to go to the University of Georgia in 1961, that is called integration. Well, Martin Luther King says that's token acceptance. So by the time of the call for black power, these promises of integration were insufficient to fill the extraordinary levels of expectation that were flowing in the hearts and minds of black people who expected these new laws and these new rulings to overturn a century of racist exclusion. So these insistent claims filling the call for black power had a rising sense of self-determination to determine who we were, what we wanted to see, what we thought was beautiful, what we thought was possible. As Adam Clayton Powell said during a commencement address in 1966 at Howard, and this was in May, it was before the march, he said, human rights are God-given, civil rights are man-made. Our life must be purposed to implement human rights. To demand these God-given rights is to seek black power, the power to build black institutions of splendid achievement. So our self-determination demands our rediscovery, our interpretation of our history, and the recasting of a social and collective mind toward, the way we saw it, the Black Power groups saw it, for revolution. So in one sense, you could see, and I have to say one sense because there are other senses, in one sense you can see Black Power as a revolutionary cultural force which links all kinds of activities and organization and affects an entire spectrum of life, including music and politics and families and organizations, religion, literature, and particularly politics. That was the one that I saw as particularly key, and it was a dramatic time when we organized our responses, our political responses to what was happening in this country around Black Power. There were certain qualities of experience that we had all shared, if not personally through our families and our knowledge of history. We had cultural traits that we knew, part of which rose from forced submissiveness, forced impoverishment, forced silence in the political arena. And there was a rage against all that force, all that violence, and it helped break through many of the mental and psychological restraints, including those barriers held in place, and very effectively, I might add, by Negro colleges, Negro churches, and hand-picked Negro spokesmen. So there was a repudiation of white standards, or what you would call Euro standards, of beauty, of decorum, of education, of social order. There were universities created called Malcolm X universities. Many people, some of whom are here in this room, changed whatever their name was and took on their African names. Following Malcolm, they called those names that they had that were Anglo, the slave names. And we had to rearrange what we thought was revolutionary. We had to revolutionize this control imposed on Black people. I want to share with you something that I found very moving, written by the late August Wilson. It was this part of a speech that he gave called The Ground on Which I Stand. And he's talking to a theater group about his life and his interest in theater. And he says, in another guise, he talked about the ground on which he stood in terms of a playwright, the Greek Shakespeare playwrights. But then he says, in another guise, the ground on which I stand has been pioneered by my grandfather, by Nat Turner, by Denmark Vesey, by Martin Delaney, Marcus Garvey, Elijah Muhammad. That is the ground of the affirmation of the value of one's being, an affirmation of his worth in the face of the society's urgent and sometimes profound denial. It was this ground, as a young man coming into manhood, searching for something to dedicate my life to, that I discovered the Black Power movement of the 60s. I felt it a duty and an honor to participate in that historic movement. As a people who had arrived in America chained and malnourished in the hold of a 350-foot Portuguese, Dutch, or English sailing ship, we were now seeking ways to alter our relationship to the society in which we live, and perhaps, more importantly, searching for ways to alter the shared expectations of ourselves as a community of people. And then he says, I find it curious, but no small accident, that I seldom hear those words, Black Power, spoken. And when mention is made of that part of Black history in America, whether in the press or in conversation, reference is made to the civil rights movement as though the Black Power movement, an important social movement by America's ex-slaves, had never happened. But the Black Power movement of the 60s was a reality. It was the kiln in which I was fired and has much to do with the person I am today and the ideas and attitudes that I carry as part of my consciousness. Black Power, when it was articulated, was inevitably considered to be something violent. So what I wanted to understand is, why is it when you stand up and say, we want Black Power, why is that considered violent. We've been saying we want freedom for 6 years, and now we say we want black power, and that's violent? Well, one of the reasons, I mean, it is a perplexing question, isn't it? One of the reasons is because people who said black power did not explicitly say, and we're limiting our approach to passive resistance and legal means. Even though most of the participants had been highly motivated and engaged in the passive resistance movement, but as the mindset was being changed, the reading changed, and people were reading Fanon's The Wretched of the Earth, readings that particularly transformed how we in the Black Power movement thought. Because it's plain as day, Fanon writes about the colonized, the Negroes mired in the mud, and the white town, how beautiful and well-lit it was, how powerful it was, and how the violence which had confined the colonized group was going to be unleashed and become the means of their liberation. So this issue of violence became very central to all concerned, most of the discussion about the Black Panther Party. When I asked students who have heard of the Black Panther Party, I said, what have you heard? You tell me, what have you heard about the Black Panthers? What's the... They carry guns. What else did they do? Oh, that breakfast with programs are back on the back pages. Cop killers, thank you. The Black Panthers are identified as a violent, but they're identified in violent in a certain way, and Black Power had that identification. It came into that identification with the Panthers. So if you look at blacks as being under domination from the outside, being a dependent as opposed to an independent people, I see a lot of violence directed to maintain a certain level of control over that community. You have to ask yourself, why would someone like Martin Luther King be killed? Why was Malcolm X killed while he was making a speech to the Organization of Afro-American Unity in Harlem? He'd broken away from the Nation of Islam. Why was Rodney King whipped? So why are thousands and thousands of black people being imprisoned for not having done anything that is violent or harmful to anyone more than themselves? So why is it when you hear about the Panthers, you hear about the shootouts? What I'm trying to get at is there is a level of violence that's deemed legitimate. So those things that are directed toward controlling a group are not ever referred to as violent. It's when you resist that control, or you even say you will defend yourself in the face of that threat of violence, and you challenge that control, that's when you become illegitimately violent. Now, at this era, we were observing, because it was television and newspaper coverage of a massive nature, we were seeing struggles in Vietnam, in Africa. In 1968, there was a very powerful film that some of you may have seen because it was re-released recently. It was called The Battle of Algiers. But it was an impact on us of seeing these Algerians in the film, the actors playing Algerians, because they just looked like black people that we knew. We didn't know what Algerians looked like. Most of you probably don't know what if an Algerian walked up here today, you wouldn't know what they were. Well, anybody in this room, and I mean this, there's not one person in this room who couldn't be an Algerian in terms of how they look, because I lived in Algeria, and I swear I never saw two Algerians that looked alike. They look like everything. They're in the Mediterranean. There's white, there's blacks, there's Berbers, there's all kinds. But the ones in the film looked pretty much like, you know, what we call colored people. So under the international law, the provisions prohibiting colonial domination authorized you to fight for your liberation if you were dominated and colonized. And as the Africans fought against the Portuguese and the British and the Vietnamese fought against the Americans, and the Mexicans fought against the neo-colonial or neoliberal government, we were seeing people fighting for their independence. I have a friend who's a graduate student who uses the, we could say that's international awareness, or you could call it the tricontinental awareness, the awareness that came out of the linking of these struggles in Africa and Asia and Latin America. And so that was a kind of consciousness that was also part of Black Power. Now, I became part of the Black Panther Party shortly after being, well, simultaneously actually, being part of SNCC because I was in the Black Power faction and we were connected to people who were involved in Black Power organizing. Stokely Carmichael went out to the Bay Area for a fundraising trip and came back and told us, that's what they've done, the Black Panthers in Oakland, they're the ones, the first ones who implemented organizing in an urban area. It was a cadre organization, and he was just so excited. So I first heard about the Black Panthers in this great anticipation, and the person I first met was who was connected to them was Eldridge Cleaver, who came to give a talk at a conference SNCC was holding in Nashville. So there were a small group who consciously took on as an organizing principle, Black Power. And it was an explicit modeling, but it was also local organizing. When I say explicit modeling, the Lowndes County Freedom Organization, which was created in Alabama after the failure of the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party challenge to the Democratic delegation in the presidential convention of 1964, after that challenge failed to unseat them, the principle of organizing became, let's not work within to challenge the Democratic Party, let's create our own party, Black community organizing in Lowndes County, running our own candidates against the Democratic Party. For those of you not familiar, this logo of the Democratic Party in Lowndes County was a rooster, white rooster, with a ribbon around it and said white supremacy for the right. The logo of the Lowndes County organizing, Lowndes County Freedom Organization, was a Black Panther. And so the press began to call that the Black Panther Party. And after Huey Newton and Bobby Seale had created this platform and program for an organization, they had an idea, but they didn't have a name. And that Huey Newton had seen this pamphlet for John Hewlett's campaign. It said, pull the lever of the Black Panther. And they read the pamphlet and they said, well, that's it. That's it. We want to be like that, but we're not a running candidate, so we'll call our organization the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. And I was told that Huey wrote a letter to SNCC in Atlanta to their headquarters and asked for permission to use that drawing. And so there, when I say explicit modeling, there was a sense of this is the image for Black Power. The Black Panther Party started out as being called the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense, and then it later dropped the self-defense after the principle of patrols was eliminated by change in the law. But in reality, this national group, and there were many bodies calling themselves the Black Panther Party, was not only the one in Oakland. There were groups in Atlanta, there were groups in New York, there were groups that used this principle, this Black Panther organizing, what the one that you came to know most, because it became the largest, was the Black Panther Party based in Oakland. But the the principle I want you to understand is even though this group based in Oakland with one central committee, one 10-point platform, one had numerous different incarnations and was really a cluster of organizations and a cluster in a movement all bearing the same name. Now, I don't want to go into a lot of detail about the Black Panther Party, but I think it was distinctive in terms of many organizations, cultural, political, social, black caucuses, black political groups, all kinds of, there was an explosion of organizational activity that characterized the Black Power movement. But I want to talk about some of the ways in which the Black Panther Party based in Oakland, started in Oakland, was distinctive. For one, it constituted itself at the beginning as a vanguard organization. That meant it wanted to go out in front and create a model for liberation. although it began to function because of the Free Huey mobilizing and other reasons, began to function like a mass organization, that created a certain type of tension in what's required to be a vanguard and what's required to be a mass organization. When I first met the Panthers, they were a tight, disciplined organization with clear rules. And after the arrest of Huey Newton in a shootout, he was imprisoned in Oakland and charged with murder. That was about the time I came out to work with him full time in November. He was arrested in October. By that time, the organization had kind of fallen into, let's say, less than cohesive situation. They had no office. They weren't publishing their newspaper. There was a professor at Merritt College named, or school teacher, I'm sorry, public school teacher named Welvin Stroud, who gave them an empty apartment and said, well, you could use this. And they, four or five guys, Eldred and six teenagers, would sit there and say, we got to do something, we got to do something, we got to do something to free Huey. So this was a low point in their organizing. Eldred was in his 30s. Bobby Hutton was about 16. The Forte brothers, I think, were 18. And so this is where what you became familiar with as the Black Panther Party came from, again, when it rose back. I was the one that suggested, well, maybe they should have some demonstrations at the courthouse to draw attention to the fact that he was going to court. And they said, well, they don't like that idea. They don't like marches. But they'd march for Huey. And so we began to hold demonstrations, build the awareness of the case. I took the name communications secretary because I had seen Julian Bond do what they called the communications director, I think. That meant you sent out press releases and kept the public advised of what was happening in your struggle and also kept attention on you in case the police did anything harmful to you. Much of the early interaction and how the Black Panther Party was going to function grew out of discussions, private discussions, public discussions, ideological, personal discussions between Seal and Newton and Cleaver. But then once Newton was in jail, it began to change. And Eldridge Cleaver was the one that sort of moved to the forefront, not because that was a decision, just because he was the only one who could speak publicly. Bobby Seal was in jail after the Sacramento visit, and Huey was charged with murder. And there he was. He was on parole, and he said, well, I guess I have to recognize that it's more important to keep Newton out of the gas chamber than to keep myself out of San Quentin. So now the Black Panther Party was structured as an above-ground or overt political group, but it also had covert or underground structure. I was not a part of that, but I did know that it existed. After Martin Luther King's assassination, which was in April of 1968, the appeal of the Black Panther Party and the look of the Black Panther Party and the posture, the self-defense posture, this aggressive, we're not taking it anymore. We're going to put an end to this or die trying. Eldridge Lee Cleaver used to say, here we come, ready or not. You know, that was sort of like a kamikaze, like we're going to run out there and make things happen, make things change. So Oakland, Los Angeles, San Diego, Sacramento, Seattle, the party spread across California, spread to the Midwest, spread to the South, spread to the East. People in New York told me, we saw what happened to you, how the police dealt with you before it happened to us. They kind of knew what was happening. And I think it got more and more violent as the repression moved across the country. When I left the United States, and I left in May of 69 to join my husband, who had miraculously been bailed out after being arrested in a shootout with the Oakland police, even though he was on parole, he got out briefly. When the Court of Appeals ordered him back, he decided, he said, well, I think I'd like to go somewhere other than San Quentin. And he went to Cuba, and I thought I was going to meet him in Cuba, but we ended up meeting in Algiers. It's kind of the way it was. You never quite knew from day to day where you might end up, but you knew what you were doing. Maybe not where you would be, but what you were doing, and what we were doing was fighting for Black liberation. But when I left, there were 33 chapters. So between May of 69 and November of 67. That tells you how rapidly this organization expanded. Now, I can't at all tell you that members of the organization went out and planted and organized and built those chapters. No. People in those communities would organize and tell us they were members of the Black Panther Party. In fact, they would compete to be members of the Black Panther Party. Bobby Rush in Chicago said there were three. There were three different groups in Chicago that claimed to be the Black Panther Party. He said, but I had the presence of mind to put a telephone in our office. So when Bobby Seale came to visit Chicago, I could say, we are the Black Panthers, and this is our phone number. So I think it was something about the Black Panther Party that was captivating. It attracted young people who had seen these civil rights protests, but they saw something that was urban, that was abrasive, that was cool, that they could do. There was a young woman in Chicago who lived on the south side of Chicago. She was about 17 years old. She saw a film. She said, I think Stokely Carmichael came to speak, and he showed a film about the Black Panthers. And she learned about the Black Panthers from that film, and she said, I've got to go out there. She moved to California to join the Black Panthers. She didn't even know there was Black Panthers on the west side of Chicago. So, I mean, there were people leaving home, showing up. They did that for the civil rights movement. They did it for the Black Power movement. They wanted to join. They wanted to, I don't know if they really wanted to serve breakfast for children, but they wanted to be in this movement. They wanted to stand up. They wanted to fight the power. They wanted to be liberated. They wanted to be heard. They were mostly very young, although we had one man who joined the party in New York. He was the only man that had gray hair. We called him Chairman Brothers. He's still alive. Chairman Brothers is in his 80s. And if you call him up, he'll answer the phone, fight the power, light the fire. We saw ourselves as revolutionaries. I will say the experience revolutionized us, what we saw happening to others revolutionized us, what we saw happening, and there was something extraordinarily empowering about seizing the time, defining yourself, knowing that you might lose your life, but you would go down for something that meant something. And there is nothing similar. And it's almost impossible for you who are college students now, to imagine that experience. I know that. I've asked people. They say they can't imagine it. Learning, as I have later, about the young Vietnamese who fought in the National Liberation Movement, I saw a documentary about the photographers, actually, Vietnamese photographers, but it included what I discovered, that they were like us. They were young people who were determined, no matter what, to fight for their country. They were going to give their lives to bring about a change in the world they lived in. The same is true in Mexico. The same is true in Zimbabwe. The same is true in Guinea-Bissau. We learned how to think like revolutionaries. We learned how to commit like revolutionaries. And we backed up what we believe with our lives. This movement, and other movements. I can only speak of the international dimensions of the Black Panther Party, but there were other movements, I assure you. There was a Black Power movement in Trinidad. There was a Vanguard Party in the Bahamas. There was a movement in Bermuda. I'm not quite sure of the name. In London, the movement that the Black Panther Party symbolized spread in two basic different ways in the sense of the international headquarters. We ourselves organized in Algiers. We had the status of a liberation movement, and we called it the international section of the Black Panther Party in Algeria, which was supported by the Front for the National Liberation of Algeria. But in another sense, our mode of organizing had become a model that was adopted by dispossessed and racially distinct groups in other countries, including Israel. There was a Black Panther Party in Israel of mostly Moroccan Jews, ethnically distinct Jews, and that chose the name the Black Panther because of the discrimination they felt in housing and jobs and politics. And in fact, they transformed and became quite part of the political, electoral political scenario in Israel. In India, the Dalits adopted that structure for Dalit Panthers. The Dalits are the name of the untouchables. There was a group in Australia. And so what I'm saying is that the Black Power concept as an organizing vehicle unleashed this creative, imaginative challenge to authority that took forms in different ways in different parts of the world at different times, but it was triggered by that same call for the dispossessed to rise up and claim their human rights that came from Mississippi. Now, there were other cultural responses, political responses. I have no time to go into all of them, and I'm sure at this conference you've been discussing them. There's many, many issues and many other critiques, but I would like to say that Nixon also decided to join the crowd. But his idea of Black Power was a little different. I was speaking of the revolutionary part, and then there's the reactionary part, and he called it Black Capitalism. And they have quite a legacy. There were those who said Black Power is green power. Well, I'm not quite sure they meant environmentally conscious, you know. There were Black caucuses in unions, Black caucuses in psychology associations, Black caucuses in professional organizations, Black studies, which is now called, oh, it's amazing, it's called African American studies, it's called Africana studies, it's called African New World studies, it's called diaspora studies. It's absolutely extraordinary. All of this come from the insistence that we be able to use the institutions of education to understand our culture, understand our heritage, increase our awareness. I don't remember anyone saying, and we want a Black Studies department so we can all be tenured. No, that wasn't it. Although, there's not anything wrong with that. But now, let's get into this business of colonize. And I know I'm probably running way over time. I need to get to Sabotage, so I'm trying to get into the Sabotage area. But I had a student ask me a question. There's an essay that I had assigned to class, and he was kind of confused about something. And he said, well, explain to me this issue of colonization. He said, you said that we were colonized like Africans, even though the Africans were separate, like Angola is separate from Portugal. So if they're separate, how does that make us colonized? I said, that's a very good question. Now let me explain. And I drew a map of Africa and I said, here you have Guinea-Bissau, here you have Angola, and here you have Mozambique. They're discontinuous. They don't have common borders, but they're all Portuguese colonies. They're all administered by Portugal. They're all engaged in a liberation movement to fight for the independence from the same government. And that concept of discontinuous colonization being dominated by the same power, whether or not you're in the same place, said we didn't invent it. We adopted it from Amilcar Cabral. And I was using that to contrast the claim that rose out of the civil rights movement that we were second-class citizens and we wanted first-class citizenship. And I said that in the Black Panther Party, we did not see ourselves as second-class citizens. We saw ourselves as subjected to a form of colonialism, a domestic form of colonialism in the United States, whose constituents were slavery and then segregation. So he said, well, I think there's a problem with that analogy. And I said, well, there is, although let's look at it this way. We were studying, we were beginning to read This Little Light of Mine, which is a biography of Fannie Lou Hamer. And Mrs. Hamer talked about how she wanted to be a first-class citizen, and she wanted the right to vote. So I said, well, if you're living in Sunflower County, Mississippi, which is dominated by Senator James O. Eastland, and there will ever, never be any federal protection of your right to vote, you will be beaten, people will be lynched, houses will be set on fire because you are attempting to exercise your rights to register to vote. In order for Mrs. Hamer to experience what it is to become a first-class citizen, the effort and the change is the equivalent of ending colonialism. So I said, even if you don't call it that, and Mrs. Hamer went to sixth grade, Her education took her up to the sixth grade. Well, Stokely Carmichael had a bachelor's degree in philosophy, and he could read Frantz Fanon, and he could travel around the world. He could meet Fidel Castro. He could participate in conferences. So he can discuss and describe the situation Ms. Hamer experiences on a more complex level, but when you get right down to it, we're talking about an end of a form of total domination based on race and power. So we, those of us who believed we were colonized, said the distance is not the physical distance between the mother country and the colony, but it's the difference, the gap in our lifespans, the gap in our education, the rate of incarceration, the differences in our health status, the differences in our wealth status. So these are how the colonized are separated from those who are in the majority. Just as we can look at African countries that became independent, got their own government, got their own flag, didn't get their own economy, the Gold Coast becomes Ghana, Rhodesia becomes Zimbabwe. But guess what? They don't control their countries. So that's a form of what you call neo-colonialism. Black faces without control. Well, it's not really that different to where we are. Listen, you have a Kwanzaa stamp. Hello? You can mail a letter and put a Kwanzaa stamp on it. You laugh. You don't think that's freedom? We have black mayors in many cities. Guess what? When do the black mayors tend to win the election? Tell me. When the white people have left and the budget is collapsed. Right? When the economics of the city hit the toilet, then the blacks can have it, right? But then when gentrification comes, guess what? Guess what happens? Where's Charles Jones? What's happening in Atlanta with our gentrification? You think we're going to have another black mayor? He says not for too long. No, because the whites who went to the suburbs, now they want to come back. And so I'm bringing this up because you're taught to understand democracy. You're taught to understand your citizens' rights as a citizen. You're taught to understand you can participate in the economy. You can just work hard. The government will protect this. The government will protect that. Well, when you figure out that that's not true, how do you explain it to yourself? You don't have an explanation. Well, if you understand that you were subjected to a form, a condition that was analogous to colonialism, and that the change that you have gained is analogous to neocolonialism, then it helps to understand that. Now, sabotage. Just begin with the origin of that word. Sabot is a French word. The workers in the 19th century could throw their shoes into machinery and mess it up during a strike. So sabotage means you're going to mess it up. And I'll tell you, they're going to mess up black power. There were many levels of sabotage. If you go to the Kerner Commission, President's Commission on the Study of Causes of Domestic Unrest, or Civil Unrest, I think they called it, otherwise known as the Kerner Commission because it was headed up by the governor, Otto Kerner, the governor of Ohio, they claim that the cause of this unrest in the cities was white racism. It's very clear, that's the cause. It wasn't caused by agitators, black militants, no. It was caused by white racism. So what is the cure? Well, they act like it's impossible to cure white racism. They don't propose any cure for racism. What they propose is, among other things, better police informing. We have to have more information about what's coming down. We have to have a different structure of control. Yeah, they have to have better job training, and they have to have, but basically they need better police, better policing. The Kerner Commission, I think, was released about, but it was written, they were writing this in 67, right? And J. Edgar Hoover in 67 was articulating his COINTELPRO, counterintelligence program, for all the different, I mean, the COINTELPROs existed. It just is a format, an acronym. They had them for the communists. They had them for the Klan. But in 67, he's articulating one to get rid of what he calls, he, J. Edgar Hoover, the head of the FBI, calls the black hate groups. Now, if anything, the black power movement was full of love. If anything, it was a black love organization, a black love activity. But to J. Edgar Hoover, it was a black hate. And the top 10, the top five of his black hate leaders were Elijah Muhammad, Martin Luther King, Max Stanford, who's now Muhammad Ahmed, head of the Revolutionary Action Movement, which was underground, which is probably why it doesn't mean anything to you, and Stokely Carmichael. And he said, these people are trying to become a messiah who could electrify and unite the black masses, and so we have to prevent that. But the thing that I think is significant, he had a 5-point of things that they wanted to prevent, but the most important one for our purposes, he wanted to prevent the black groups from gaining adherence among the young people. Wanted to make sure that they didn't essentially adopt these ideas, join these movements, and come to fight for their own liberation. Now, there's memo that one of the FBI agents in San Francisco sent to J. Edgar Hoover, which is very chilling. I'll never forget this. It was dated March 9th, 1968, and it's about 3 pages, but the point that this is so chilling is he says, the black youths, I think he probably said the Negro youths, but I'm just going to say the black youths want something to be proud of, but they need to know that they should be athletes or something other than revolutionaries, because if they become revolutionaries, they will be dead revolutionaries. And that's just one S special agent writing to the director, giving his views of, based in the Bay Area. Now let's get precise. Mumia Abu-Jamal, who some of you may have heard of as a death row prisoner, he's also a writer, was in high school in 1967. He went to Benjamin Franklin High School. The FBI asked the Philadelphia police for a photograph of Mumia. And Mumia has a file in the FBI. His address is called Benjamin Franklin High School. They wanted a file on him because they heard him speak at an anti-war rally, and they picked up on how quick and how gifted he was. And so they got a photograph of him, and that photograph is a picture of him in a, has a beret and a black leather jacket. And on the back of that photograph, I don't know whether it was the Philadelphia police or the FBI, somebody wrote his number, the number of this file, and dead. And there's another way of sabotage that your generation has seen the consequences of. You didn't see it happen. When I say your generation, I mean you students. This has happened to my generation. After the sudden explosion during the Vietnam War period of the Black Panther movement, you know, just captivating town after town, large towns, small towns, no towns, you saw an influx of drugs, hard drugs, heroin. And then later on, that pattern became, as you know, crack. But to wipe out a generation, the very same age group, the very same population that would have joined the Panthers or would have joined the Sons of Malcolm or would have joined the People's Party or whatever the local revolutionary group was, they're going to get pacified and destroyed by drugs and then violence. I mean, it's so heartbreaking because when I talk about my friends and we talk about people who died of our age group, we talk about people who died because they went to Vietnam or people who died because they were killed in the civil rights movement. But you talk about people who died because they walked down the street, because they were in the neighborhood, because a stray bullet hit them, or because they were gangbanging or whatever. But still, there is not a political context to this death. It's a low level of genocide. And then there was another level of sabotage, and it's called simply, let's call it co-optation. Let's make sure that we can create, and is Robert Allen here? There you go. He wrote extensively about this in his classic book, Black Awakening in Capitalist America. Let's create this buffer, this class of black people who will be subservient and participant in the corporate structure. And they will be the buffer between the dominant group and the lower group. And I tell you, that's a heavy one. That is a really, really serious long-range plan that's working. And then there was the way the media has been manipulated. Well, first of all, the media has been concentrated and the independent media reduced. The numbers of corporations that own newspapers, television stations, and radio stations is getting smaller and smaller. The range of information you're getting is getting smaller and smaller. But the manipulation is very effective. There's a documentary made about the Black Panthers in New Haven, and the structure of the story is a group of high school students, about 12 high school students, are doing an after-school project of oral history, and they go around the community and ask people what happened during the Bobby Seale trial, what happened during the big May Day demonstrations, and what did you know, and where they interviewed the police chief, they interviewed the Panthers, they interviewed their neighbors, and one of the young high school women in this interview, she said, well, I kind of knew about the Panthers. See, my grandmother was in it, so I knew about them. And she said, you know, those times were different. She said, you people, you had leaders. You had Malcolm X. You had Martin Luther King. He said, all we have is Jesse Jackson and Al Sharpton. He said, they're kind of like substitute teachers. And so all those phenomena pulled together in collaboration with, I think, the most vicious, and that is the use of a policy of targeted human rights violations. I call them human rights violations because that's how the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in South Africa would call them. But let me just tell you what they are, and you can decide. The use of murder and assassination, severe bodily harm to eliminate those who are in opposition to the hegemony or the domination of the larger corporate America. The use of the legal system to charge people with extraordinarily lengthy, serious crimes, like the way, for example, they charged Angela Davis with felony murder. Had she been convicted, she'd still be in jail, like Rochelle McGee, her co-defendant, who's still in jail. But the use of the legal system, if they're not framing you, then if you actually did something that they have convicted you of, then you get an extraordinarily long sentence, like a young white American revolutionary named Marilyn Buck, who was arrested and convicted of buying ammunition with a fake ID. And it wasn't just that she bought the ammunition. If she bought the ammunition and gave it to a Black Panther, she got a 10-year sentence. So that's something they don't like. They don't like white girls giving Black Panthers ammunition. And the use of the media, it's a term we call black propaganda. They'll plant stories about your organization or about you that aren't true, give you a case in point. There's a leader, former black leader of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, whose name at that time was Rap Brown. He is now known as Jamil Alamin. Now, Rap Brown was the chairman of SNCC in 1967. And during that period, 67, I think from May 67 to May of 68. So during that period, there was a short period of about 4 months in which the Black Panther Party and SNCC had a type of an alliance. It was a very short period, okay? Maybe 4 months. And for how many years was he an imam? 17 years? Let's say for 17 years, he was the imam of a masjid. He became a Muslim. He was a prayer leader, an imam of a mosque in the West End of Atlanta. So he gets arrested and charged with murder in a shooting incident in Atlanta, in which two deputy sheriffs who were supposed to serve a warrant on him at 10 o'clock at night claim that they found him and he opened up and shot them and killed one of them. Okay, the story hits the papers and it said, ex-Black Panther charged with police killing or cop killing. And I said, what ex-Black Panther is this? And I started reading and I said, how in the world is he? Okay, it's not that. It's that, like you said, Panther means cop killer. So you say he's an ex-Black Panther, case closed. They didn't want to let you on and the real reasons that he was arrested, but which has to do with his participation in Muslim activities. But then that's what we call black propaganda. Then there's the use of chemical and psychological warfare. And your organization is highly subjected to psychological warfare without even knowing it. It's like you don't even know what's happening. You don't even know how much information is being kept from you. You don't even know what kind of messages are being sent to you. You don't even know what's in the food. No, let me go. Don't let me go on. But the ways in which that tremendous energy and excitement and sense of possibility and creativity was unleashed in the Black Power movement, the ways in which it was incorporated into some form during the Black Power movement are deeply, deeply compromised by the ways in which it's been sabotaged, which we could go on. This could be a whole course. It could be a whole library. It could be a whole conference. However, I am not depressed or repressed or convinced that they're right. Truth pressed to earth shall rise again. Shall rise again. And where we were and what we have to do is so significant, you have to pick up where we left off. And we've made a lot of mistakes, but you have time to correct them. So please, continue the struggle. As Martin Luther King said in 1958, you have to keep moving. Keep moving, keep learning, keep struggling, keep loving, keep doing it. Power to the people. Thank you.
That's all right.
You leave. Sorry.
All right, we're going to take about 20 minutes worth of questions. Here's a few ground rules. We actually are looking for questions. Okay. Must be shorter than a minute.
Please, I wanted to know what were your thoughts on the situation that's happening on the west side of Chicago dealing with Fred Hampton Way and how basically what they're trying to do is they want to have a street named after Fred Hampton, and the Fraternal Order Police was like, he's a cop killer. You made reference to that they're saying the first time they think about Black Panthers is being a cop killer. What can we do on the West Side to push our leaders to keep that going forward so we can make sure we have this block named after that brother? Thank you.
Well, first of all, you have to unmask this insanity. Fred Hampton was murdered by cops.
That's right.
So let's get this one thing straight. Fred Hampton, there was a lawsuit. It took them 13 years to finally get some compensation. Fred Hampton's son was in the womb of his mother when the police went and shot his father, who was drugged, in the head. He was already dead. Police in Chicago, according to Fred Hampton's son, now I haven't seen this with my own eyes, but he told me that every year they go to the cemetery and shoot Fred Hampton's tombstone. So that's who the people who are opposing it are. So I think you need to have a campaign of exposing the FOP. Bring out why they don't want this street. And I was on a talk show with someone who called in, and he says, street's not enough. I said, that's right. He said, you need a statue. So raise the stakes. Raise the stakes and say, we want a street with a statue of Fred Hampton on it, okay? And start raising money, but more importantly, raise hell.
Okay, everybody can hear me. All right, this question is related to a statement that you made about Black power is related to green power.
Mm-hmm.
And my oldest brother is from 71. He was born in 71. My youngest brother born in 90. So mm-hmm. I like to look back and forth and see how things have changed. Something that my oldest brother was telling me, he said that my father's generation, father born in 50, so that general time frame. You were saying that they were more entrepreneurial than our generation is.
No. Okay. I wasn't saying they were.
I wasn't. I wasn't agreeing with him either.
Oh, okay.
So I was saying that I was thinking about it.
Yeah.
So I was saying, did you think that their generation was more entrepreneurial, and if you did or did not, did you think that that was somehow related to this idea of Black power being green power? That was my question.
Well, let's say when your father's generation, which is my generation, was coming up, there were limited opportunities for Black entrepreneurs. For example, you could have stores in the Black community to serve a Black market, but you couldn't have, let's say, well, they didn't even have McDonald's, so but you couldn't have a McDonald's franchise because they didn't have McDonald's. But the recognition that let me go back. I did a study when I was in college of the history of New Haven Blacks, because I went to Yale as an undergraduate in the 80s, and I was stunned. I went to the library to look up a book about Black people in New Haven. I'm assuming it's like Chicago or any other major metropolis. They got to have some book about them. Well, I found one book that had been written in the 1940s, and the way it had been written, it was like, ooh, look at these people from another planet, these Black people. I said, wait, you know, there's got to be more than this. And there wasn't, in terms of a book. So I did these interviews, and I interviewed one of the older citizens, and I asked him something about his life, and he said, well, I was the first Black bank teller in New Haven. I said, oh, really? And this man was in his 80s, and I said, and when did you become that bank teller? He said, 1962. So you have to, this is New Haven. This is not in the Deep South. We're not talking Mississippi here. So the opportunities to participate in the broader economy were limited for your father's generation. So it was Nixon who announced that Black power was Black capitalism, and that he wanted to encourage Black participation and give grants. And there was also the issue of this poverty program, and what was it called, Job Corps. They had all these different government-funded programs, and what would happen is you get the money, and when you cooled out and not demonstrating or challenging things anymore, then guess what? Grants over. Finish. Particularly if it was a poverty program, which was based on maximum feasible participation of the poor as a premise, and when the poor actually got to participate, then they'd lose the grant. So to say that that generation was more entrepreneurial is kind of unclear to me what he meant. What it might have meant is that they recognized that if they were going to accomplish anything, they're going to have to do it on their own, that they couldn't expect to apply to University of Illinois and get a scholarship for African Americans, you know, that there were fewer opportunities. Does that answer your question? Yeah. They didn't have these NBA, what do you call them? Multimillionaires playing ball. You didn't have Michael Jordan restaurants. You didn't have, what's this famous ball player, Magic Johnson movie theaters. You didn't have all that. So that's why it's hard for me to understand how his generation was more entrepreneurial. I'm just not clear.
Hi. My question is in regards to, you seem to make a distinction between the word liberation and freedom, and I want to ask you how you feel about freedom schools, the Children's Defense Fund Freedom Schools, and the opportunity that they have as a mobilizing agent. I work with CDF as an Ella Baker trainer in, you know, the light of SNCC and the organizing, and how that creates this intergenerational dialogue between communities and creates a social consciousness of the need for social action in communities. So I just was unclear if you were making a distinction between liberation and freedom.
What I was making a distinction was when the Freedom Now slogan got replaced by Black Power, then the term liberation and the Black liberation struggle replaced the idea of the freedom struggle idea, not the idea of freedom, but the idea of we're struggling for freedom, kind of fizzled out after the Civil Rights Act was passed. It felt like, okay, now the law is in place. But the issue of liberation from domination that wasn't just about civil rights. So I'm not sure it was all that clear cut, but the group that I was part of, the people, we kept using the phrase Black liberation, and that linked us to liberation in Africa, and it had more of the sense of against colonialism, against imperialism, because when you say the freedom struggle, it didn't by definition say it's against imperialism. It might be just against, you know, those, Stokely said, make them crackers impotent over our lives, you know, but it's a bit much broader than that. But there's no connotation at all that there's something wrong. No, there's, if anything, we need more freedom schools. Everybody needs to be a participant in a freedom school for their, that's the other thing, is that people have to understand when you join a movement or you participate in a movement, you have to recognize that's for your benefit. You are the one that's going to benefit from this, in addition to those people you're helping. And then you understand that when you're in a freedom school, right? Yeah.
What would you say are the aspect, what are the aspects of the 1960s and 70s Black community that allow Black power to flourish so quickly, and what continuities have you identified in today's society?
What have I identified?
What continuities of the Black power movement have you specifically identified in today's Black community?
Well, for one, that we call ourselves a Black community.
Right.
That was hard. That was hard. I mean, Black was a term of abuse. Don't you call me Black. I mean, you could get into a fight with calling somebody Black. So that's behind us. This idea that Black is beautiful. We don't have to tell you that anymore. We all know this. This is part of the culture. We've accepted this. That you could go wear African clothes somewhere. That's not an issue. Not really. But what I think the most important part of is what you asked. What allowed that to flourish? That why would our community embrace that so quickly? And I think it's the consequence of 12 years of mobilization, activism, constantly seeing, you know, that people were on it. When Stokely used this phrase, get yourselves together. That was like, we got to get ourselves together. We got to get right. We have to, there was all this sense of energy that the people had died, they'd given their lives to bring about changes. Young people, the four little girls have been bombed. I mean, it's like there was this identification, a larger identification with the, on the part of the larger community of the smaller number who were actually kind of on the front lines, and the sense of pride in what they were doing, a sense of that's for us, that's about us. Today, when you look at someone like Clarence Thomas sitting up on the Supreme Court, it's real hard to feel that that's about us. However, that's a co-optation. It's sort of like we're supposed to be tricked. Just think, because he's got the same color skin, that he thinks the same kind of thoughts. And the fact that you can make that distinction, however, it was hard at the time that he was nominated. It was hard. And I don't know how you feel, but there's a lot of people had nasty things to say about Anita Hill, all right? Because Anita Hill challenged this appropriately. She challenged it, and there were a lot of people didn't want to hear what she had to say. So how is there a continuity? The fact that you can have the kind of courses that you have in African-American studies, the fact that new African-American studies departments are being opened. I think one year I gave a talk at Holy Cross, which is a Catholic school in Worcester, Massachusetts, and that was maybe 1996, and they were so proud that they had just started having an African-American studies program. But that these things continue, it's sort of becoming part of the culture, that people learn about Black History Month from stamps, from little things on television, that we're sort of, I call it the quarantine. History, what I teach is mostly about slavery, and I said, well, the history of slavery is over here in the quarantine. You can't find out about it in the regular curriculum. You have to come over to, and when I said, many of my students are law students, I said, well, where do you have to come to find out about slavery? He said, over to African American Studies. You know, so, but at least there is a place to go. So when your parents were in school, they couldn't teach this. It wasn't available. There were books, there were studies, it just wasn't acknowledged as a valuable part of the education. This is hard to say this, but somebody like Condoleezza Rice, who is, you know what Aaron Magruder said when they both received NAACP Image Awards? And he said, what's her award for, the most embarrassing Black woman in history? but she is so clearly identified with Bush and the Bush family and the Bush family politics, but the fact that they feel comfortable in using a Black face to express their politics, that's the bad side. I mean, that is part of that legacy, isn't it? I mean, it's not the good side, but it's a way of confusing us. Let's see. Somebody here help me out. You all of these professors. Hey, Earl, help answer this question. Yeah, he teaches Black Studies at Penn State. Hey, come on, give me some more help on this one.
Kathleen, you're doing a wonderful job without me.
Well, here's one of the legacies, Professor Jones. Professor Jones is the director of the African American Studies Department at Georgia State, which is one of those departments that combines service and scholarship.
Right.
Really right. All right. All those books that are in the bookstore that I see listed in your program, that's part of the legacy. But the real legacy is what you, as young people, take away and how you continue this and how you can have a sense of who you are and possibility and how you can connect. And this is the important thing. Connect in the collective sense to continue the advancement of this community that's so fragmented and demobilized.
Thank you for your presence here today. And I want to continue with the words that you just said and incorporate integration and how it has made natural hair, especially Black women's natural hair, locks, braids, and image, and in the workplace that is unacceptable. And why are we as Blacks still battling in this millennium to not look through the through Toni Morrison's bluest eye, and why are we constantly diminished to an image?
Well, the short answer is because white racism is alive and well, but let's go to the long answer. And the long answer is that the attitudes that were supported by institutionalized and legalized segregation and racial control, even though the laws have changed and the institutions are beginning to modify, inside the heads of people, these attitudes continue. Mm-hmm. There's a reproduction in the families. Okay, when there was a rash of what they called church burnings in the 90s, there was such an effort on the part of the mass media to say, oh, no, 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 these aren't white racists. These are, they call them firebugs and people who wanted to get their name in the paper. And they had all these crazy descriptions of what these people, why they were setting fire to these churches. Like we remember in the civil rights movement, they go set fire to a church because that was where people were having meetings mm-hmm. to contest segregation. So there was a form of intimidation and terrorism. Say, oh, no, 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 it's not that. Well, in fact, it was that. It was a right-wing activism on the part of these groups that, you know, there are many more groups than the Ku Klux Klan, and they're much more Nazi-like. And so the rise of that kind of, I don't know if you're familiar with this book called The Turner Diaries. It's written by a former professor. He got out of the academy because he felt that the, you know, the presence of black people showed that, you know, white supremacy really wasn't doing the job. And he created this, has a farm in, is it in Virginia? McDonald, what's his farm? He has a farm in Virginia where he essentially produces a lot of literature for the Aryan nations and the white, what do you call, identity cult and, you know, all that kind of undercover white supremacy organizing. We used to hear a lot more about before 9/11 than you hear now, because now they're really worried about Arab terrorists, so we don't hear about those white terrorists as much as they, but I don't think they've closed up shop. So that has an impact. That means these aren't people, this isn't Preacher Man, the man who murdered Emmett Till. That man's in his 80s. These are younger people. So there's a way in which the beliefs in white supremacy are being propagated, and people elected to judgeships and people elected to being presidents of corporations who have these beliefs. And they hold their beliefs just as strongly as I hold my beliefs about the importance of black solidarity, black community. But I think my beliefs have a civilizing impact, and I think their beliefs have a savagizing impact, okay? Because they act like savages because of what they believe. And I don't think that that's how people who are in the black power struggle act. To make a long story short, when you wear your hair and you demonstrate that you are proud of having some African ancestry, it upsets those people. Mm-hmm. And they want to make that an illegitimate expression. I think once I went somewhere, I had braids and then I changed my hairstyle, and some store I went to said, well, I didn't like that other hairstyle. And I felt like, well, I don't care whether you like it or not. I don't wear my hair for you. I didn't say anything, but I put my braids back. One more question, I'm sorry.
Thank you. Hi, I'm a master's student. I'm graduating in May, and I'm in speech communication. I'm really excited about it, too. And, and you know, as a black young woman, I'm thinking, oh, man, I have so much, you know, behind me. I have so much education. I have so much that I can do with what I have. I have youth. You know, I respect my elders, and I really want to get as much as I can from them and all that good stuff. And I'm thinking, what would you do if you were me?
I'd start saving money. That's what I'm saying.
I'm on it.
Having said that, not ever, just now, I mean, I'm like probably twice your age, and I'm just now figuring out, you know, I need some investments here. I.
You're serious. You are.
I would do as much as I could to participate in enhancing the life experiences of younger women. You know, with girls' clubs, with just young, to make sure that those positive attributes that you are fortunate to have, that there are young people who get to see, there are women who do that, who have a chance, because that's not the message. I saw the most disturbing article. Well, there's always disturbing articles. This one's really disturbing. Some woman is circulating this, and the tagline was, say it's not true. What kind of propaganda is this? But the article was an article taken from the Washington Post. And the title of the article was, Marriage is for White People.
I remember that.
And she went on and talked about how she was a single woman, and she thought eventually, you know, she'd like to have a family, like to have a house, like to get married. But by this time in her life, she already had a house. And the guy who proposed to her, she says she didn't want his children. She just really don't want to be, he waited too long. But since she said that the children in her class, her classroom, she's a public school teacher, was saying, oh no, you know, like we want to know how to have families, and we want the men, they want to learn how to be good daddies. He said, well, do you want to get married? Oh no, 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 no. Marriage is for white people. And I said, what kind of thinking is that? I mean, the fact that you could categorize a social activity that every community in the world has some way of forming families, and to say in this, so we've got so many negative ideas being foisted into our community, so we need the positive voice, the waves of affirmation, of beauty and love from black people in our community. But then just put money in the bank too.
Okay, you got it.
Can we get the brother with the tie? One more.
Actually,
who is it? Yeah, you.
Just
one more question.
Okay. Thank you very much. In terms of the earlier question about entrepreneurism going from black to green, the question that the young man in the front answered, historically, blacks have been taught to get jobs, and we've constantly fought for education. Now that we can get education and get degrees, it seems as though people are only satisfied with getting a job. And I think his earlier question was the comparison between entrepreneurs presently and historically. And it seems that now we have more opportunities to create entrepreneurs.
I think there are more entrepreneurs. Yeah. I think there's more of them, yeah.
However, individually, because people have more choices now, it seems that more people are simply settling for the education. That's only my opinion. I just wanted to know if you could.
Well, I just think, you know, what we ought to do is do some studies. Because there's these young men who do, young engineers who are coming up with ways to use the internet, corporations. I just got something in the mail. Join the largest black internet community, commit.com. There's just, you know, people making all kinds of hair products, people going into building, people, I don't know. It just could be because I'm based in Atlanta. I see a lot of black business orientation. Now, when I'm in New Haven, I don't see any of it.
Okay.
I don't see none of it there. That's a depressed community.
Okay.
But when I'm in Atlanta, I see a lot of it. So I just think it's hard to say, you know. I bought, for the first time in my life, I bought an issue of, what's this magazine, Earl Graves, Black Enterprise?
Black Enterprise.
Because it had a little headline about, you know, how to invest your money. I said, yeah, I need to know that. But I never ever thought, that's what I'm trying to tell you. First of all, I never even thought I'd live long enough to do this. So, but I have 9 grandchildren. So I figure I have to stick around and find ways to put money aside. So by the time they get older, there'll be some money there for them. But that's the kind of thinking that my parents indulged in. Mm-hmm. But I never thought like that. So, but I do think that what we did, my generation, and correct me if I'm wrong, there's enough of us here, but I think what we did is invest in the future of our people. And we put everything we had into changing the opportunities for our people, and we were not really expecting, like Martin Luther King said, he said, yeah, I'd like to live a long life, but that's not the most important thing. So we were entrepreneurs about
people.
Black people.
Okay.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Ms. Cleaver, for investing in us. Thank you.